Good morning, subscribers. It's Saturday here, March 11, 2017, and I'm in Sydney. Before I start, I would like to acknowledge the elders of the Eora people, of the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, past, present, and future, who are the traditional custodians of the land on which I am recording this. So, we had some good feedback from the pilot episode of Confessions of a Complex Human, and we already see emergence happening because a few people messaged me, wanted to be part of this, and I already created a separate series for where I talk to people and one-on-one. Maybe we could try more than two in the future, but for now it's one-on-one. We already have the first episode with Marcus where we talked about creative intelligence and innovation, product design itself, the future of work, robotization of things, universal basic income, and all that. So you could check that out if you're interested. And thank you for those who shared the first episode and who commented. So in this episode, I'll talk about what Oliver mentioned, the NBN, which is the National Broadband Network here in Australia. I'll talk about what Louise mentioned about passwords and how we feel about privacy of our stuff that are digital. So let's start. So first, I'll talk about the privacy issue that Louise mentioned. So a lot of our lives, if you really think about it, is becoming digital. And if we just step back, it's quite a strange thing that there are countries in the world where they'll rather have Wi-Fi than proper working toilets. It's interesting. And a few years ago, I was traveling through Vietnam and I could see these internet cafes. And they were full of young kids. It's like all these internet cafes around the country, they're all playing games. And it seems that they were there the whole day because we were traveling the whole day. I was backpacking with a good friend of mine. And we would just walk around and throughout the whole day, we see people, you know, throughout the whole day, we'll check our emails every now and then. And whenever we go to these internet cafes, you can see all these young people spending all their time in front of these computers. So a big part of our lives has become digital, and it goes into many aspects. So there's a book which I'm going to read it now that I remember it because of this episode. It's like how the book discusses how increasingly algorithms are making important decisions on our lives. For example, if I apply for a loan, it used to be that there's a loan assessor, a person who would look at the paper file and look at my credit history, and before he approves and I get the money for the loan. And increasingly parts of these are being automated. I'm not sure to what extent because I haven't worked in that industry for a while, but there have been news reported that a lot of things happening in the background are algorithms. There's also going back to last week where I went to this Nuco event, and in the first episode I mentioned I went to Airtasker. I also went on that day. I also went to Quantium, and they talked about data-driven strategy and how they're collecting massive amounts of data from companies like Woolworths, the NAB, and real estate companies. So they have all this data on what people buy, and what people spend on and what's in their grocery basket. And then they clean up all this data. And that's an interesting thing to notice, that the one of the most expensive parts, or maybe not most expensive, but most time-consuming part, is getting all the raw data from the companies and then cleaning it up, putting it into neat tables so that you could do proper analysis. So they have a long process of cleaning the data, and then once the data is clean, and data scientists would look at it, and they would see what insights can be gained by playing with the data. And of course, Australia has privacy laws, and the way they do it is, although they know the data, they don't know the person. So there's this thing called hashing, where you know that a certain raw data is unique because it has a unique it has to do with cryptography. It's a unique cryptographic hash, but you don't know the identifier. So it's like the records are de-identified. And which brings me to Louise's point that Facebook was one of, actually I think started with Friendster, and even, and I think really Facebook is the one who really pushed for real identities on social media, social networks. Prior to that, if you join these networks, you can be anonymous. And they've done well with that because revealing your true identity sort of creates this reputation system, which was followed by LinkedIn for work, etc., etc. So now, yeah, and then companies like Airbnb and Uber and Lyft, they all rely on the reputation of a person, and that can only happen if you disclose who you really are. So back to Airtasker, they've now partnered with, according to the co-founder, they've now partnered with the Commonwealth Bank, which is the biggest bank in terms of customers, number of customers in Australia, since they've already done, I think we call it in Australia the 100 points test, which is it's like you know your customer requirements, so that before you open a bank account, you have to prove who you are. So since they've already done that step, Airtasker is partnering with them so that people who provide the services to do the tasks in Airtasker, if something goes wrong, then they could work with Commonwealth Bank to trace where these people are, to prove their identity, so that it provides this level of safety. So there's all these things going on in terms of identity. Identity is an interesting topic in itself, like in terms of digital identity and identity in a philosophical sense. Well, that has always been a big topic. Who am I? Who am I really? Who am I in front of this webcam? Who am I in front of my friends? Who am I when I'm alone? It's an interesting topic, and which we could talk about more if you like. Just comment and let me know if you would like to delve into that. And just before I forget, another person who contacted me from episode 1 is Julie, and we've scheduled to do hangouts on Tuesday, and we're Tuesday Australia time, and we're gonna talk about consciousness-based astrology. It's how planetary forces influence our consciousness, and maybe it depends on how it goes, we might also talk about sourcing things inside our consciousness, which can lead to past life regressions or other stuff that's affecting our consciousness right now. So if you're interested in that, subscribe so you'll know when it's happening and when it's ready for you to watch. So going back to digital identity, so the thing is, so we have this digital identities in our Facebook profile, Google Plus, LinkedIn, and the one challenge with that is, as the title of this series is, Confessions of a Complex Human. We are complex beings. So I am not just my job. I am many things to different people. And it keeps on changing. If I link it to one identity, like if you look at my Facebook feed, it's so eclectic because I don't filter, you know, there is an ability to group your friends and then choose the audience for your posts. But I haven't done that because really it's hard to determine because not that it's hard to determine, it's also a philosophical thing for me because if I noticed this during the Trump campaign, that all my the feeds I was getting was anti-Trump because most of my friends are leaning towards that side of the spectrum. And I could see firsthand what Cass Sunstein has been talking about for a long time. It's the potential for online communities to have this echo chamber. So it's interesting that at first we think that when people discuss issues, they broaden their mind, you know? The more you discuss it, the more you get new perspectives because you're discussing it. That's true if the people discussing it are diverse, right? There are diverging points of view. But if the people discussing it are of the same point of view, then what happens is it's a positive feedback loop of they just egging each other on. You know, if you keep on preaching to the converted becomes extremists, right? Basically, they become radicalized because you're just feeding this reality. And if the way, if like mass media, one of, you know, although it has its flaws, one of the thing with the mass media provided is that we have a shared kind of reality. Because we, like, I remember a time when everyone would sit at 7 o'clock at night to watch the same news show or to watch the same primetime TV. So this is shared culture facilitated by mass media because everyone's watching it. Everyone knows what's going on. But now that's all blown up. It's all niches, all Chris Anderson wrote a book called The Long Tail. So you still have people like Taylor Swift who have loads of followers. But then there's a long, long tail of people who have like 1,000 followers. Or, you know, they're niches. They're like, and then people have now these sub-identities or subcultures happening everywhere. You know, there's anime, people who love anime, people who like gaming, and so there's no really, you can't really say what an average, like when people say she's Australian or he's Australian, and I go, what does that mean? It's quite, in my point of view, there's not one idea of what an Australian means because Australia has changed. There's a lot of people who are second, third generation Australian who are way out of the Crocodile Dundee stereotype that people may have, you know? So identity is complex, and when we tie it to one profile, then it becomes problematic. And also there's this issue that as a young person, we're more risk-taking in what we post. But then it stays, right? If Facebook stays in business for the next 100 years, there's a record of all this foolishness. So on one hand, people are worried that it's like scandalous, like shit, you know, that there's all this record of me getting drunk and doing this stuff. And what if I run for office? That will affect my candidacy and things like that. So one way of doing that is not to post, but the other way of doing it is just having the attitude, so what? Because we have this illusion that that politicians aren't humans, but they're humans. Of course, they've done fucked up things in the past. And I was just this one forum I've been, this one forum, you know, Facebook group where I'm a member of, and there were people attacking this teacher. It's self-development work, and they were attacking this teacher, and most of the attacks were, how dare she teach about this? She comes from this broken family. She was abused. She lost a lot of money. And now she's a guru. She's now an authority. And I just said, that is the point. She's been through a lot. Then I could learn a lot from her. What do you want? Someone who has been in an who's lived a pristine life? What would you learn from them? You know? It's like, we're jumping a lot now, but we'll just go with it. It's like this concept of being anti-fragile. It's a big topic, but just to give you a small snippet. Like, being anti-fragile is you're exposed to a lot of changes, a lot of changes in your environment. And the more you get exposed up to a certain extent, the more you thrive. That's being anti-fragile. Fragile is things that hate change. Like if you drop a glass at a certain height, it will shatter. But when we walk, when we run, we're actually stressing our bones. But they don't break. In fact, they become stronger. In fact, if we don't stress our bones, we get weaker. That's why astronauts who go on space, their bones become so weak because there's no gravity there, so that they're not, the bones are not getting the stress that they want and they need. Wow, that was fast. So that's 15 minutes. So I'll just quickly wrap up. And we didn't get to the NBN, but we'll get to that in the next episode. So going back to the bone thing, so a lot of things in life are actually anti-fragile. They need to be stress after a certain level, because without those stress, they cease to be alive, to function properly. And this goes back to complexity. Complexity is not about, people think it's about the parts. It's not about the parts. It's the relationship between the parts. And it's a relationship between autonomous agents, things that act on their own. Yet, because they're connected with other agents, something emerges. So in a way, life is an emergent property. That's why people can't pinpoint what is like how to create life, because it's not about the ingredients. It's how you mix the ingredients and how the ingredients are reacting to each other. So going back to that anti-fragile point, if things don't get stressed, then they, like bones and things like that, they atrophy. And it applies to the financial system, and I'll discuss that in future episodes. So it relates to complexity, because in a complex adaptive system, it all relies on the feedback between the different autonomous agents. So without that microfeedback, the emergence doesn't happen. And without the emergence not happening, the whole system goes dead. So I'll end with that, so we can keep the container. It's important that we keep the container. And for those who haven't, please go to YouTube and press the subscribe button, so you can subscribe to this channel, so you'll know when the new episodes come and you can watch them. Also, keep the comments coming so I could respond to them. And if there's any topics you want me to talk about, let me know. And enjoy your weekend. I'm going to a nice lunch for someone's first year in this world, the first birthday, so that'll be fun. I hope you're doing fun things today, and goodbye.